All right, before, this has nothing to do with the course, but Wolfgang Rudolph was, had set this demo up for his optics course, so I looked at it and said, geez, you ought to have it for the students in each of this course. Unfortunately, the thing is a little bit loose. But since there are only a few of you, why don't you all come up here and stand around the thing? Just don't look into the laser beam. So beam comes up, hits a mirror that lets that reflects some of the beam this way, which then comes back this way. And then some of the beam goes through the mirror, bounces off that mirror, comes back, bounces off that mirror, goes through. And so we get an appearance pattern here. And now if this thing was set up so that we could just move this thing back and forth, that bright spot there would go bright and dim. Instead, what happens is as we turn this thing, we get fringes. I was getting nice fringes earlier. These don't look quite so nice.
That
was
better there.
It was?
Yeah.
Yeah, there we are. Well, you can see the fringes. You can see the fringes. If I lined this up better, they'd be more dramatic. But and of course, in the real Michelson Morley experiment, what they originally tried to do was to set it up with the beams going in the one of them in the motion in the direction of motion that the Earth was moving, and the other one in the opposite direction. And then we rotate it. And verify the one. Anyway, I just thought I'd show you that. It's not particularly relevant to anything we're doing today. But what I would like to do is I'm going to finish complex variable theory, at least finish the discussion of that subject in this course today, and move on to differential equations. And I may tinker a little bit with the next homework assignment. So before you do the homework assignment, and in particular what I may do is I may make the last two problems extra credit and add two others that are a little bit that don't involve strings. And that might be more sensible. So look at the online notes when you do the homework. But you can do the first few problems without worry, because I'm not going to change them. So let's see, are there any questions? Okay, so let's see. I've got the usual supply of crackers or no?
Sure.
So we were talking about Feynman's propagator and the Cauchy principle value and so forth, and I think we have finished that. So the next topic, if I'm not mistaken, yes, it's dispersion relations. And so let me tell you about this. The idea, again, is pretty simple. The reason why we have dispersion relations is that basically we expect to have a causal relationship between an effect at time t.
and the cause at time t prime. So,
in the world of Alice in Wonderland, this effect would depend upon the cause of all times, and we have some transfer function f hat of t minus t prime, which we call transfer function. Probably a better name than that for that function. If anybody wants to shout it out, I'd be grateful. In any event, as I said, in the world of Alice in Wonderland, this is what we have. But in the real world, as far as we know, what we have is e of t is an integral not from is an integral such that, in other words, f of t minus t prime is non-zero only if t minus t prime is positive. And so what we can say then is that this is really an integral from minus infinity to t of f hat of t minus t prime, c of t prime, d t prime. So in reality, that's what you have. In other words, f hat of t minus t prime is zero if t prime is greater than t. So in other words, an effect at time, a cause of time t prime has an effect at time t only if t prime is less than t. And of course, that's what we normally expect. But that means then that these transfer functions, thought of as a function f of t, f hat just of t then, is zero or t less than zero. And so the Fourier transform of the transfer function, which we could call f of z, which would be an integral minus infinity to plus infinity, f hat of t, e to the I zt, dt over root 2 pi, well, this thing is actually just an integral from 0 to infinity, f hat of t, f hat of t e to the I z t dt over root 2 pi. So it's that kind of a sort of half Fourier transform. And what that means then is that if this transfer function f hat of t, which is non-zero only for positive t, if f hat is any kind of a reasonable function, then this f of z is going to be analytic, and in fact, it's going to be analytic in the upper half plane and well-behaved in the upper half plane. Okay, because as you let z acquire an imaginary part, because t is always positive, the real part of this would always be negative. If the real part of this will always be negative if the imaginary part of z is positive. So in the upper half plane, this thing is damped, and this function is well behaved. Okay? So I z t is equal to I x t, which is kind of irrelevant, minus y t. So if a big y, since t is positive, this thing is damped. Okay, so what we can say then is it's worth thinking about functions f of z that are analytic in the upper half plane, UHP, upper half plane, and moreover, well, and on real axes, and I guess that requires some restrictions on f hat, but we'll assume they exist. And we'll assume, furthermore, that as r goes to infinity,
the absolute value of f of r e beyond theta is 0 or 0 less than or equal to theta less than or equal to pi.
So in other words, as you go out in the upper half plane, either on the real axis or up into the upper half plane, the absolute value of f goes to 0. And now that's certainly true if you go up for any function defined like this. That'll certainly be true is if you go up into the upper half plane like that. What's not clear is that it's also true if you go out on the real axis, but we'll assume that f hat is such that that's the case. All right, and if f is, if f hat, for example, is square integral or behaves nicely, then that will be the case. All right. Now, since we have analyticity in the upper half plane, we can certainly write f of z0 as 1 over 2 pi I integral f of z over z minus z0 dz, where this is some contour that goes around the point z0. And in fact, we can take this contour, if we say that z0 is in the upper half plane, then we can take this contour to be one that goes along the real axis out to big R, goes up like that and down to minus R, and then comes along the real axis from minus R to plus R, with z0 being somewhere in the upper half plane. Then what we recognize is that this part of the integral around that huge shot around the upper half plane, that's going to be a ghost contour because the limit r goes to infinity of 1 over 2 pi, I'm taking the absolute value of this thing, but just along the ghost contour. See, I shouldn't have a zero on this time. This thing is less than or equal to the absolute value of f of r e v I theta. The dr here is going to be r d theta, and under here z minus z zero is essentially going to be r. The r's cancel, and so this is the limit r goes to infinity of absolute value of f of r e to the I theta, and that's zero by assumption. So the ghost contour is zero. We drop the ghost contour, and then what we have then is that this, in fact, is just 1 over 2 pi I integral minus infinity plus infinity f of x dx over x minus z0. Z0 again for the upper half plane. And now, since we're really interested in f on the real axis rather than off of the upper half plane, we now let z0 drop toward the real axis. And in other words, we let z0 equal to x0 plus I epsilon. And then we say f of x0, one plus I epsilon there, but we'll assume it's continuous so we can avoid that. Integral minus infinity plus infinity f of x over x minus x0 minus I epsilon dx. I remember last time we talked about Cauchy's tricks, these I epsilon tricks that physicists are always using. And remember, it's 1 over x minus x0 plus or minus I epsilon is the principal part of 1 over x minus x0. minus or plus I epsilon delta of x minus x zero. So those are the tricks, and we use the bottom trick, and so this is equal to 1 over 2 pi I integral minus infinity plus infinity, whoops, principal part of f of x over x minus x zero dx plus I, this is not I epsilon, it's I pi. Plus I pi over 2 pi I integral f of x plus f x minus x zero dx of x minus x zero minus infinity plus infinity. And so this gives us f of x zero is principal part over 2 pi I integral minus infinity plus infinity f of x x minus zero plus a half f of x zero. Yeah, there's no more x minus x zero over here. So it's just a half f of x zero, and so finally, subtracting a half from both sides, what we get is f of x zero is equal to principal part over pi I integral minus infinity plus infinity f of x dx over x minus x zero. So this is the sort of archetypical dispersion relation. Over dispersion relation. And like many names in physics, the name got stuck at some time in the distant past. Not all that distant, about 100 years ago. And
It's, I don't know if you're not, it's flickering like you're still standing there.
I'm sorry, say it again. It's flickering like you're still standing. I don't know if it's recording properly or not.
I know. I've sometimes, here, let me give you a common joy.
I can make sure it's plugged in, but I, no, I just don't know what it is. It sometimes happens.
Okay. So it just like happens.
Yeah, I don't know what to say. The real question is, does it make any difference? I've been sufficiently narcissistic to watch these tapes for more than a couple of minutes, and so I've never checked to see whether at some point things start flashing.
Okay, is there any question? Are there any questions?
Okay, well now, what's common, the common thing to do is to break f into its real and imaginary parts. So we write f of z is u of z plus I v of z. And, this dispersion relation then looks like this, u of x0 plus iv of x0 is principal part over pi I integral minus infinity plus infinity u of x plus iv of x over x minus x0 dx. And now you can split this into its real and imaginary parts. And the first one is principal part over pi equal minus infinity plus infinity v of x over x minus x0 dx. And then minus I principal part over pi integral minus infinity to plus infinity u of x over x minus x0 dx. Now, these are obvious. These are obviously split into two. One complex equation is always equivalent to two real equations. And so, in particular, here, u of x0 is principal part over pi integral minus infinity plus infinity v of x dx over x minus x0, and v of x0 is equal to minus principal part over pi integral minus infinity plus infinity u of x over x minus x0 dx. These things are said to be Hilbert transform relations. So they're dispersion relations, but they're called Hilbert transforms. Any questions? All right, now, it's often true that this function f of x, or equivalently u and v of x, make physical sense only for positive values. The variable x, for example, might be energy. And so we're interested in the thing for positive energy, not negative energy. But we've got these integrals going from minus infinity to plus infinity. And so what one looks for is some sort of a symmetry that allows you to relate the negative value, the functions at negative on the negative real axis to their values on the positive real axis. And one example is, well, f is the Fourier transform. It started out as a Fourier transform of some transfer function. And so if that transfer function is real, then the Fourier transform obeys what's equation 3.23, which is to say f star of x, which is u of x minus I v of x, is equal to f of minus x, which is u of minus x plus I v of minus x. That tells us that u is even and v is odd. And in that case, bingo, those integrals over the negative real axis are now gone. We don't need them. And instead, the Hilbert transform relation from u of x0 is 2 principal part over pi integral 0 to infinity. Well, what you do is you write this for maybe I should do this in a couple of steps rather than just go to the answer. So let me give you a couple of steps. U of x0 then, of course, is principal part over pi integral v of x over x minus x0, and you write it here as dx, plus u of minus x0 and an overall factor of a half. This then will be a half, and this will be that, plus u of minus x0 would be plus v of x over x plus x0. I've done this right. And so now we have p over 2 pi actually I'm doing this. I've done this dumb. Let me restart. I did this somewhat stupidly. This thing is principal part of pi. I mean, we have the answer here, but principal part of our pi integral 0 to infinity d of x over x minus x0. But now the part on the negative real axis then is plus d of minus x over minus x minus x0 dx. So that's the whole integral, right? And so this is p over pi integral 0 to infinity d of x 1 over x minus x0 minus 1 over x plus x0 dx. And now when you rationalize those things, what you get is v of x times x plus x0 minus x minus x0 over x squared minus x0 squared dx. And there the x is canceled and you get a 2x0. And nuts. Alright, what did I do? Oh, B is odd. So there's a minus sign here. So this is a plus, and so you get 2x, the x zeros cancel. So in other words, the formula is then u of x0 is in two principal part of pi, integral 0 to infinity, x v of x, that's because of 2x, over x squared minus x0 squared dx. And a similar manipulation with v gives v of x0 is minus 2x0 over pi, principal part, integral 0 to infinity, u of x dx over x squared minus x0 squared. So, because the function f was assumed to be the Fourier transform of a real function, we have these symmetries for its real imaginary parts, the reflection principle, and the Hilbert transform become this. So now we have dispersion relations that don't require input from the negative real axis. They only refer to stuff on the positive real axis, which is presumably more physical. And these dispersion relations like this have been used in optics, in electromagnetic theory, in atomic physics, quantum electrodynamics, advanced quantum mechanics, quantum field theory, scattering theory more generally, and in particular, in one of the dark decades for quantum field theory, a decade in which, apart from Plashow and Feynman, nobody seemed to know what to do. A lot of people turned to dispersion relations and did essentially nothing else. In a nutshell, it went wrong. Okay, so let me though get back to an application of this, the product relations. And so what we say here is, there are two ways of going about this. One is in non-magnetic materials of low electrical conductivity, sigma, at frequency omega, the index of refraction is approximately n squared of omega is epsilon omega, that's the permittivity, plus 4 pi conductivity over omega times pi. And now as
omega goes to infinity, epsilon goes to 1, and so n squared goes to 1. And so what you can do is you can write a dispersion relation for n squared of omega minus 1. So this is the function that we're talking about, n squared of omega minus 1. And so you write relations like this for those two, for n squared of omega. And in particular, what you get then is that the real part of n squared of omega 0 minus 1 is, or effectively the real part, well, all right, I'll write it this way, 2 over pi principal part integral 0 to infinity omega imaginary part of n squared of omega divided by omega squared minus omega 0 squared. The omega and the imaginary part, well, 1 doesn't have an imaginary part, so the imaginary part of n squared of omega 0 is equal to minus 2 omega 0 over pi principal part integral 0 to infinity real part of n squared of omega minus 1 divided by omega squared minus omega 0 squared. So these are the application of these relations to n squared minus 1, and we just assume then that the real imaginary parts of the n obeys this relation, f star, n star of omega is n of minus omega, because n is the Fourier transform of something that is real. Or we'll just assume these relations. Anyway, it turns out that what Kramers and Cromie wrote down was slightly different from this. They relied on some work by Morentz, who had shown that the index of refraction is related to the forward scattering amplitude, f of omega, by the formula 1 plus 2 times c squared over omega squared n f of omega. So there's a relation between the index of refraction and the forward scattering amplitude, f of omega. And so they use this formula. They use this formula and apply the Hilbert transform relations. Real part of n of omega is 1 plus 2 over pi principal part integral 0 to infinity of omega prime imaginary part of n of omega prime. Notice this is n, not n squared. E omega prime over omega prime squared minus omega squared. Now, this Lorentz relation tells us the relationship between the real and imaginary parts of n and the real and imaginary parts of forward scattering amplitude. And in particular, it tells us that the imaginary part of the index of refraction is 2 pi c over omega squared, the density of scatterers, imaginary part of the forward scattering amplitude. Moreover, there's another theorem that you learn in quantum mechanics classes, and that is it's a very deep relation. It's true not only in the non-relativistic scattering of a particle off a potential, but it's true, as far as we know, in quantum field theory, and it's in string theory as well.
namely that the total cross-section is equal to 4 pi over the 3 momentum times the imaginary part of the forward scattering amplitude. Or equivalently, for photons, 4 pi c over omega, imaginary part of f of omega.
So the imaginary part of the index of refraction, which occurs up here, related to the imaginary part of forward scattering amplitude, which in turn is related to the total cross section, which is, of course, measurable, which you can measure out to infinity without an infinite amount of money, but you can say something about it. When you put all this together, you get that the real part of n of omega is equal to omega squared over 2 pi squared c. Integral 0 to infinity, sigma total of omega prime, d omega prime over omega prime squared minus omega squared. So this, whoops, big mistake here, isn't that? So now we've got the real part of the forward scattering amplitude. Okay, well, I'm going to drop this at the moment there and go on instead to pick up some other topics in complex variable theory. And then if we have time today, we'll come back to this and discuss slow light, fast light, and backwards light. Remember, you ask a question, you get a piece of candy. All right, conformal mapping. The idea here is very, very simple. It's that, first of all, what is an angle in a complex? Conformal mapping is mapping by an analytic function. It preserves angles. That's why it's called conformal. What's an angle? When you have two little things here, dz and dz prime, the angle between them, theta, well, what is it? Well, obviously, it's just dz prime over dz, and this would be, if they're both of length epsilon, it's epsilon ei theta prime, epsilon ei theta, so it's ei theta prime minus theta. So that's the angle between them, well, theta prime minus theta. So the angle, which we might call phi, e to the I phi, is theta prime minus theta. Now, what happens if, well, I should have used chi, but I'm going to use phi or something else. Now suppose that we make a map here. Z goes to W, which is f of z, and I'm going to write W as rho evi phi. So what happens to these lines if we make this map? Well, these two things get mapped into dw and dw prime, where dw is f of z plus dz minus f of z, which is just f prime of z dz, and dw prime is f of z prime, z, not z prime, z plus dz prime minus f of z, which is f prime of z dz prime. Notice that you can do this because the definition of differentiability or analyticity in the complex plane is that the derivative should exist no matter how you come, no matter how the limit dz goes to zero, whether it goes to zero along one line like that, or a little line like that, or spirals in, or whatever. And so you have the same f of z prime here Whereas if you were dealing with an arbitrary function of x and y, then this derivative and that derivative would depend upon the angles that dz and dz prime made in the complex plane. So now, the angle d phi is obtained by taking the ratio dw prime over dw, and that's evi phi prime over evi phi, and this is f prime of z dz prime over f prime of z dz, and this is just dz prime over dz, and this is just evi phi prime over evi phi. So the angles are preserved. Now, are they always preserved? Well, they're preserved if what I just said makes sense. What I've just said makes sense as long as f prime of z exists and isn't zero. If f prime of z is zero, then dw isn't equal to f prime of z dz. Dw is whatever it is, but f prime dz is zero. So this is if f prime of z is not equal to zero. So analytic functions preserve angles as long as the derivative isn't zero. Well, what happens if the derivative is zero? Well, in that case, of course, you'd have dw prime would be f double prime of z times dz prime squared over 2. Dw would be a half f double prime of z dz squared. And now, evi phi prime over evi phi would be e to the 2i theta prime over e to the 2i theta. So the angles are double. If x prime equals 0, but f double prime not equals 0. And in fact, you can show, and I have an example that shows it explicitly, that, question?
This would be d omega prime over d omega equals e to the I phi prime over e to the I phi. But it's theta.
And so yeah. The double derivatives?
No, it's theta. For the theta, right? That theta is supposed to be phi, right?
Oh, yes. Thank you. All right. So that's great. No. Corrections get candy also. All right. Okay, so basically, if all the derivatives are zero except the nth derivative, then the angles get multiplied by a factor of n. And an example of that is the monomial z to the n at the origin. All derivatives are zero except the nth one. Yeah?
Sorry, but can you go over again how you got from there to there?
Where to where?
Sorry. from the end. Yes. So you've got those formulas there with dw and f prime. And
right.
How did you get from those to those formulas over there with f double prime? In case the first derivative is zero.
Oh, how do you go from that to that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, always what you've got here is you've got a dz and a dz prime, and then because of the conformal map, you're looking at dw prime is f of z plus dz prime minus f of z. And in the ratio, that to dw is z plus dz minus f of z. And so this thing is always 1 over n factorial The nth derivative at z times dz to the n, where this, where n is the first non-zero derivative at the point z. Well, I'm sorry, that's the numerator dz prime. The denominator is 1 over n factorial fn of z dz to the n. And so all together it's dz prime to the n over dz to the n. And these things have the same modulus, just a different e to the I theta prime, e to the I theta. Okay, so let me give you your handy. Okay, so so much for that. You can read the example in this thing. The next thing is the method of steepest descent. Sort of a funny name. Here what we're thinking about is one approximate some integral. It's an integral from A to B. Some function f of z, e to the x, f of z, dz. We imagine that A and B are two points in a simply connected region in which the function f of z, and for that matter h of z, is analytic. So you have a simply connected domain of elasticity. So the value of this integral only depends upon the endpoints, and we can do it like this, or we can deform it to that, or we can deform it to this, or this. We pick whatever path is easiest to evaluate. And okay, now what we're looking at is we're looking for a point where this is going to where f of z is equal to zero. F prime of w. So we're looking for a point where the derivative of the function f is zero. And remember, the real and imaginary parts of this function f, since f is analytic, these real and imaginary parts are harmonic. Okay? They're harmonic. And so the real and imaginary parts of f can't have a minimum or a local minimum or a local maximum. Instead, at a point like this, you have a saddle point where one has negative curvature, the other one has a positive curvature. Or rather, I should say, the real part has negative curvature in one direction, positive curvature in the other direction. Because
if this is f is equal to u plus iv, then u x x plus u y y. Zero and same thing for these.
Okay, so we're going to expand f of z around this point. It's going to be f of w plus a half z minus w squared f double prime of w. Now that's because the first derivative vanishes at w. So the Taylor series has, the second order Taylor series just has two terms. And I'm going to write this derivative f double prime of w as rho e to the I of b. And we're going to choose a contour through the saddle point that goes through the saddle point w as a straight line. Z is equal to w plus y e to the I theta. So in other words, if this is the point W, and we're going to go through this at a particular angle, theta, and then we're going to vary Y. And what we want is along this line, we want the real part of this thing to be negative. And by the way, I should have said, we're looking at this in the limit as x goes to infinity. So we're evaluating this integral not for all x exactly, but for very large positive x. And so for very large positive x, then, if this thing is negative, the thing gets really, really damaged. Okay, so what we want is v minus w squared, that's this thing here, f double prime of w is then going to be z minus w is going to be y squared e to the 2i theta, and then you're going to have an e to the I phi and a rho. We want this to be less than zero. And so that'll be less than zero if 2 theta plus phi is equal to pi. EBI pi is minus pi. Okay. In that case, this f of z is approximately equal to, of course, this is approximately equal as well, to f of w minus a half rho y squared along this line. And because z is this, ez is ebi theta dy, and so this integral up here, I of x is approximately integral minus infinity plus infinity h, I'm just going to take as h of w, because what varies is the what counts is the exponent, not the constant factor here. So I'm going to let that be h of w, e to the x, f of w plus a half, z minus w squared, f double prime of w, leave it like that, dz. And then this is going to be, well, we can pull out the constant term. So we can pull out the h of w. We're going to pull out e to the x f of w. And then the rest of this is, the dz is e to the I theta, so we have plus I theta, and the rest of this is integral minus infinity to plus infinity e to the minus a half rho y squared dy. Well, Gaussian we've done many times, so I'm not going to worry about deriving the value of the Gaussian. And so, let's see. So what we have then is that I of x with big X is approximately h of w e to the I theta e to the x f of w square root of 2 pi over x rho. That's from the Gaussian. Now, this e to the I theta, we know something about theta from this. In other words, e to the 2i theta is equal to minus e to the minus I phi, because you multiply both sides by e to the I phi, you get minus 1. And so what we can do, well, first of all, we can write it this way, h of w e to the x f of w square root of 2 pi over x rho e to the minus 2i theta, but 2 theta is pi minus phi, and so this is equal to h of w
EZX SFW square root of 2 pi over minus x rho e to the I phi, but that is h of w e to the x f of w square root of 2 pi over minus x f double prime of w. All right, so that's altogether the formula that we get. And if, in fact, there are several saddle points, then you sum over the saddle points. Okay, so that's how that is. All right, now I want to switch quickly to phase and group velocities. So this is something that you've no doubt learned, but it never hurts to see this sort of thing twice or three times.
So suppose A of x and z is some amplitude e to the I px minus et over h bar.
So I'm talking quantum mechanics here.
A of b dt,
so the simplicity one dimension. We can rewrite that as integral e to the I kx minus omega t a, well, we can rewrite it as b of k. B of k dk. And in fact, b is equal to a is called a. So b of k is h bar a of h bar k. All right. Now, the phase velocity is the velocity that keeps the phase constant. And so it's the relation between x and t. X equals b phase t. And we want it so that k vpt minus omega t should be constant. And these are some constant. So differentiating with respect to t, what we get is kvp is equal to omega, or vp is equal to omega over k, which is also e over p. So that's the phase velocity. The group velocity is more subtle. Group velocity is the relationship between x equals vgt that makes the exponent stationary. Stationary with respect to p. So the point is, we're integrating over p. We don't want these phases to cancel, and so we want the derivative of this with respect to p to be constant. And so we have ddp ddp of px minus et equals 0. So this is x minus t ddp equals 0. And so x, of course, is ddp times t. So vg is dd. So that's the group velocity, which is also d omega k for the h bar and so forth. If you let e be p squared over 2m, you see the group velocity is p over m. Okay, so now we're going to try to get this slow and fast light done in a flash. All right, when light traverses a medium, the frequency is related to the wave number by ck over the index of refraction. So this is, in fact, in another sense, it's a dispersion relation. The phase velocity, then, is omega over k, which is c over n of k. And so
for n of k greater than 1, you have a slowdown in the phase velocity. And if we think of the index of refraction as a function of the frequency, which instead of the wave number, then by differentiating the equation omega n of omega equals ck. So that's omega n of omega equals ck, thinking of a function of omega rather than k. With respect to omega, what we get is, we differentiate with respect to omega, we get n of omega plus omega dn d omega equals c dk d omega. And dk d omega, well, c is equal to, omega is equal to kc. And so dk d omega is 1 over c, so this is equal to 1. And so what can we do? Omega equals kc is true only if we don't have an index of refraction. So I don't want to use that relation. What I want to use is just this. And the group velocity then is d omega dk. So that's 1 over this. And so this gives us the group velocity as c over n plus omega n prime, where this is the derivative of the index of refraction with respect to the frequency. So this is the group velocity. And optical physicists call this the group index of refraction. Ng is n plus omega n prime. And so then you get Vg is equal to c over Ng. And of course, the Ng is n plus omega. Okay. Now, optical physicists have done in the last, I guess, it's been fairly recent, I think it's like the last 10 or 15 years, is they've looked at materials where this n plus omega n prime is, for example, huge. Not just like 1.5, you can find for glass, you know, n is 1.2 or 1.4 or something, but you can arrange that n plus omega n prime, instead of being 1.5, is 10, 100, 1,000, a million. And so the group velocity of light slows down from 300,000 kilometers per second to 30 miles an hour, you know, something that would be legal on Lomas. In fact, some days you think that almost the speed of light is legal on Lomas, that goes so fast. But anyway, that's called slow light. And in fact, this derivative can be negative. And if the derivative is negative, you can arrange to have this thing less than 1. That's called fast light. And if you pick your material suitably, you can arrange for this thing to be negative. Then the group velocity is negative. That's called backwards light. All right, so let me give some quantitative examples here. We're actually going to have enough time to do this. I wish, though, that I had a decent blackboard. Dark. In universities that are actually well-funded, there's a person who comes in and washes the blackboard between each class so that students can see what is written on the board. As you might know, this is not one of the well-funded universities. Okay.
So let's see. The index of refraction and of omega is, as we've seen, in fact, I think this is the Lorentz relation that I mentioned earlier, is 1 plus 2 pi c squared over omega squared, the density of scatterers times the forward scattering amplitude. So that is the index of refraction. And remember the KK relation, or at least one of them was, the real part of f of omega is equal to omega squared over 2 pi squared c integral 0 to infinity sigma total omega prime d omega prime over omega prime squared minus omega squared. Now, I'm not going to do this integral exactly or numerically for a known cross-section. I'm going to put in a simple sigma total.
I'm going to say sigma tau is sigma zero delta of omega over omega zero minus one.
The reason I put omega over omega zero minus one is to make the argument of the function conventionless. In general, you sort of have two choices. Well, let me just say, the argument of a function, whether it's a logarithm or an exponential or whatever, has to be dimensionless. And so this is what you want. And then when you do the integral, this just sets omega prime equal to omega zero. And when you have a delta function of an argument that isn't just omega, but is omega over omega zero, then you divide by the derivative of the argument with respect to omega, which is to say you multiply by omega zero in this case. So what we get is the real part of f of omega is sigma zero, in this case, over 2 pi squared c, omega zero, omega squared, over omega zero squared minus omega squared. So that's the approximation we have for the real part of f. The real part of the index of refraction, then, see, I left out a real part here. The real part of n of omega is 1 plus 2 pi c squared over omega squared n. Or maybe I should just say that. Yes. N, real part of f of omega, and this is then 1 plus c n sigma 0 over pi omega 0 over omega 0 squared minus omega squared. Alright, so the derivative n prime, or at least real n prime, is then cn sigma 0 over pi 2 omega 0 omega over omega zero squared minus omega squared.
And now the group velocity, and I guess what I should have said all over here, I was assuming that n was real, so we're talking about the real part of n over here. The imaginary part of the anyway. We then get that the group velocity is C over 1 plus Cn sigma 0 over pi omega 0. So I'm putting together here the n plus omega n prime. And this is omega 0 times omega 0 squared plus omega squared divided by omega 0 squared minus omega squared squared. There. Okay, so that's our group velocity. Now what you can see is that if the frequency is near omega 0, then this diverges and the speed goes to 0. So this is slow light. So you get slow light
omega is near omega zero.
Of course, to get this result, I made the cheapest possible approximation to sigma total as a function of omega.
All right,
we've got a minute left, so
let me give you a better approximation, and what we see is we'll get fast light as well as slow light.
So if we take a better approximation, we say that n of omega is 1 plus Cn sigma 0 over pi omega 0 over omega minus omega 0 squared plus gamma squared. In other words, we put a finite width into the line.
And its derivative, well, its derivative n prime is C n sigma 0 over pi omega 0 omega 0 minus omega over omega minus omega 0 squared plus gamma squared. And the group velocity now is C over 1 plus Cn sigma 0 omega 0 over pi omega 0 squared minus omega squared plus gamma squared over positive quantity omega minus omega 0 squared plus gamma squared. Okay. So now, if omega squared is less than omega zero squared plus gamma squared, and omega is close to omega zero, then this thing is huge and positive and you get slower. On the other hand, if omega squared is bigger than omega zero squared plus gamma squared, then this thing is negative, you get fast light. Moreover, if you pick n and sigma zero huge, and a big omega zero and a small gamma, and then take omega zero squared bigger than omega zero, omega squared bigger than omega zero squared plus gamma squared, then you can arrange that this term is so negative that it overpowers the one, then you get backwards light. And the first papers on this stuff are by Robert W. Boyd, and in the class notes I refer to that. Okay, the application to string theory, those of you interested can read it. I'm going to skip it because I think we need to have move on to different equations. And as I said to some of you before some of the people came in, I'm going to dicker with the homework. Probably we'll make the string problems extra credit, and we'll instead add a couple of more standard complex variable problems. And we still do it on the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. Oh, if anybody wants to hang around, I'll turn on the microphone while the demo, and you guys can see it and see it.